My name is Akash. Good afternoon, guys. Hello. Just to see you're awake before lunch. So the good thing is I will quickly go through slides. It's not a technical talk. I realize that there is a certain way to describe security, which basically makes any, if you're a dev, your eyes glaze over. If you're a manager in charge of making sure releases go on time, you're like, oh God, another security person gonna delay my life, and my schedule is gonna slip. So I'll try and do something very, very interesting. I'm gonna just talk about one specific thought I have with an interesting picture, okay, with each slide, and let's see if you like it. So I think it's pretty clear that we live in a container world, camp, conf world, whatever, right? It's all the same. It is a reality. There is no going back. Okay, that's not gonna happen. Unlike some of the other fads in tech that we have seen in the past 10-15 years, this one is safe. Right? That's pretty obvious, and I'm guessing that's the reason you are here for the conference. Right? What does that mean? IT and devs have to come and work together. Right? Because of a specific reason. Right? Containers have enabled that. I'm gonna cover that a little more. Right? And all of this is called DevOps. Around DevOps, based on the marketing requirement, you may have different hashtags, DevSecOps, SecDevOps, DevOps Security, DevOps Container World, whatever, right? It's all the same. Primarily, the success of all these initiatives is that the gap between what is considered operational and IT and what is considered developmental, right, either that has to reduce or it has to disappear completely. Right, this is how the world is thinking of how software should be done. Right, they call it the agile methodology, which actually came from a factory floor, right, like a physical world factory, not like a software factory. So that's interesting. But all of that's going to happen with stuff coming together. When things come together, one of the biggest challenges is always going to be about communication. Right? What is two different entities talking to each other? The only way they can talk to each other is if there's a protocol. Right? That's like standard networking 101. So what is that protocol going to be? It has to be, because there are IT is also humans, ops is, devs are also humans. So the protocol has to be some process. Right? It can't be some gibberish. There may be some way of for them to talk to each other if there were machines, but yeah, we don't know people right now. This is an interesting thing that a lot of people have started saying, which is called major shift in security. And if you miss the obvious arrow, it's like pointing to the, it should have pointed this way. Sorry, left. Because that's what the hashtag is. The security shifting left. If you're not familiar with this, the next slide will make it application security, which I call AppSec because it sounds cooler and fits in the format, has to become part of the DevOps or be left behind. That's me coming from a space of doing application security, because obviously I believe that we are part of the whole chain of things where stuff gets delivered. But for most people, security tends to be either as an afterthought or something that has to be done because it's part of the checklist. So this training, requirements, design, implementation, verification, release, and response are stages of the Microsoft security development lifecycle. Okay? And the first time this was discussed was in 2000. In 2000, Bill Gates wrote a memo for internal Microsoft employees that we have to make security first. Because at that point, a lot of Windows operating systems used to get hacked online just by being connected to the internet, right? And this is about 17 years old. This particular image is about 17 years old, right? So when people are talking about security has to shift left, it's not a new concept at all. right? Because if you look at it, they're starting a training, which is even before requirements, right? Requirements is usually the first stage when you do software dev. So all of these list of items are actually about security. So 17 years ago, people were talking about that everyone should get some security awareness training and all that, but obviously that hasn't really happened. Why is it important now? Because remember I said application security needs to be part of the DevOps movement, but you know, we're talking about containers. What's the connection? Containers enable people to do self-service. Developers don't have to raise a ticket, which may be, you know, action in 4 days to set up a new environment which has all the application libraries and the runtimes so that they can deploy their application, which can go to the next stage of testing, right? For integration, for you know, UAT, none of it, they need to talk to someone else. Containers have increased self-service. If there were ways of doing it earlier with virtual machines, possibly. But when with containers, it has just become really, really simple, right? And when that happens, you can have continuous integration, continuous delivery, continuous deployment, whatever it is, right? Whatever is the pipeline to go from here is the user story to here is the you know, feature implemented. Whichever way you look at it, what you can do is stuff on tap and containers enable it. Great. So now we are talking about containers being, you know, square in the middle of DevOps. We started with Appsec being part of DevOps, but now containers have to, you know, they are like the things we have to worry about in DevOps. And containers have some security, whatever that they have. This is a right, nice image I basically took from Stack Overflow, because that's what we do, right? When we have to look for answers, we go to Stack Overflow. There is some work, whatever, this could be your Jira dashboard or whatever else that you use for tracking your work, where dev is like, hey, I'm done. And the system is like, nope, you're not, right? It goes to, commits to the version control, goes to some automation platform, obviously that's Jenkins, but whatever, doesn't matter, right? And then there are stages. There's an integration stage, build, there is something to do, some deploy, functional testing, documentation, validation, and then you're actually done, right? So in this particular slide, what we can look at is like, where do we check for security? We can check for security at build time. When we have the stuff ready, it's ready, it's deployed. When we are saying we are doing functional testing, obviously if there is an automated way to do functional testing, you can try and do some, you know, non-functional testing there as well. And obviously when you are ready to validate, who's doing the validation? It could be the user acceptance, or it could be the QA signing off, it could be anything, right? You can check for security at any of these places. Make sense? But since we're talking about application security, let's talk about the Open Web Application Security Project. How many of you have heard this OWASP? Okay, bunch of you, great. So how do containers and, you know, AppSec and OWASP kind of map? From the position of AppSec, right, the relevant OWASP things to look at are A1 injection, broken authentication, insecure direct object reference, security misconfiguration, using components and known vulnerabilities. That's fine. If you're not familiar with OWASP, you're like, why do I care? What does this do, right? So consider that injection is stuff that harms the server. It is immaterial if the server is running in a containerized environment, or it's a virtual machine, or it's bare metal. It is immaterial for that, right? Broken auth and insecure direct object reference is stuff that lets attackers access parts of the application, which allows them to upload stuff that harms the server, right? Among other things. But the operative word is it allows access to parts of the application. Uploading stuff is later, it is post exploitation, right? Allowing access itself is a problem. Stuff that makes infra supporting the application insecure, that's misconfiguration. And stuff that possibly enables any of the above due to third party stuff, right? For example, when applications get deployed for scale, one of the things that people do is use CDNs. You're familiar with CDNs, right? What do they allow to happen, right? They basically say that I will copy some of the files which don't really change every day for you and bring them closer to the users that you have. So when this particular file is requested, maybe a CSS file, JS file, something like that, images, right? It will load from my servers, and if something new has come on your server, that request will never hit your server. Enable scale, right? What if the CDN gets compromised? Right? Or for whatever reason, you're not using HTTPS, right? That request is over HTTP, and someone manages to change the contents of JavaScript. In the user's browser, any piece of JavaScript has the same privilege as the user of your application? Yes? They can do whatever with it. That's a problem. So browser vendors figured out we should come up with something called sub-resource integrity. SRI. I don't know if you've heard of it, but it's fairly new, right? But that is to address A9 using components with known vulnerabilities. Now these components could be libraries also. So you have this whole thing about dependency management, which is required for dev, but also has security implications. So most people consider that security misconfiguration is a solved problem. If you don't realize what the image is a Microsoft tablet, right? Which is also like a computer, which has a keyboard. The problem is the lock, which keeps this physically secure, is on the keyboard. But the display and the processor and the RAM are in the part that you can just pick up and leave. Right? Security misconfiguration. There is a security control, but it is misconfigured. Right? One of the easiest ways to understand this for people who are not from systems is to think of this. The scooter on the left is like old and whatever, and the bike on the right is like gleaming chrome. Right? What's the metaphor? Unpatched, patched. We all try to solve that problem. How do we make sure that our stuff stays patched? Yes? Have you heard of Heartbleed? Anyone? Heartbleed, AWS people, Shellshock? Bunch of you have, right? Both were vulnerabilities that were possible in some component of a system, which meant that software had to be patched. Most people and teams are unable to patch stuff which is in production before, you know, the container world happened, because they were not sure if they tried to patch everything, would something else break? And if they had SLAs with other people for 5 nines, right? That's the cool word, right? 99.9939. That kind of uptime, which is like around 8 minutes in a year. Right? This is crazy, right? If that is what you were aiming for, there was no way you were patching when security folks are saying patch now. How do containers solve it? How do they solve it? Can you be louder, please? Yeah, you can do that, or you basically say infrastructure is immutable. Once I deploy my application, I am not going to do any hardening on that. What will I do? I will spin up a new container which has the latest tags, it has the latest patch, it has my app, and I'll just point to that and trash the other one. Right? That's what immutable infrastructure is. Right? There is no reason to harden every time. We just start from scratch, take the latest patch thing, and that's our updated thing. Right? VMs don't make it simple. Containers do. Right? That's what we're trying to get at. A9, using components with known vulnerabilities, maybe it is a solved problem. With, you know, private repositories, private registries, what does that mean? You do not do Docker pull from hub.docker.com. While they may be like, yes, yes, you know, we are providing you a free service and we try and make sure that this application or the Docker container is not full of malware uploaded by an attacker, right? It's kind of like a guarantee that Google Play Store gives. Their check for malware present in Android applications is automated. It has been bypassed. Right? So maybe for your personal use, you're like, yeah, I'm okay with hub.docker.com. It's a free, nice service. But for your enterprise, you're not. Right? So you're like, let's get a internal registry. Our devs will, you know, have more assurance about the containers and what it contains. Great. Right? So maybe A9 is a solved problem. Similarly, if you rely on Java third-party libraries, Node, Python, Ruby, all of them allow you to basically have your own repositories, which could have gone through a static analysis, so you know that these ones are proper and the versions are maintained and you know the dependencies are taken care of. You can do a bunch of things. So A9 is kind of taken care of. So what is the security nightmare keeping you awake? I was basically going for like a scary looking house. Doesn't look very scary, but that's the idea. Is there anything that you worry about in terms of security? Yes? No? Just say yes. Come on. I'm energetic. Say yes. Thank you. What about the application security? Right? Because what we talked about, A9, are the stuff around the application, right? That's the infrastructure required for the application. But what about the application security? And if this doesn't keep you, up at night, either you don't really care about security, or you're not responsible for security, right? Or your team is like really good. So it could be one of these three things. This is gonna burst your bubble. As I said, I do application security. Our team basically looks at applications as an attacker would, right? And we love to find secrets. So in one case, we were able to get 15 million records. Why? Because the management had weak password on the application. Management had an account, like a CXO type of account, and their password was one of the weakest that we never find, right? We found 3,000 passwords and driver licenses because the contractor didn't reset someone's password, so the site name was the password. Another case, we basically got root, like full privilege on a retail e-commerce server. This is a production server, right? Because the outsourced vendor that they were using for the content management system used the same admin password everywhere, which was their company name, right? So as part of the testing, we looked at like three other instances and we were admin on the CMS in three other places. But obviously on the server that we were interested in, we were like, you know what, let's escalate the privilege and become root, right? All these three cases are not on containers, right? Two of them are. I'm not going to tell you which ones. One is a virtual machine, right? But the reality is it doesn't make any difference to us for applications security, right? And that's the point I'm trying to make. Most people, because consider that devs and ops love automation. The way they want to solve this is by doing this. Those are CCTV cameras. So you need to repeat after me. Then monitoring is not security. Monitoring is not security. Monitoring is not security. Just having a security control or what looks like a security control, it's the same, you know, the security guard in front of the mall. We all go to malls, right? There's a security guard who has basically no clue about security, right? It's a deterrent. That is not security, right? That's how most people try to automate and not think about security, right? I'll share the slides. You can take the pick then. Sorry. I realized that they told me to finish early, so I'm trying to do that. Authentication and authorization go a long way in ensuring security of access. Okay, please note, the only specific thing they do really well is security of access. Most applications are incapable of securing themselves against insider threat. It would be just feasible and affordable to build most applications if everyone had to worry about insider threat. Edward Snowden was part of the NSA's ecosystem. If anyone has money to secure their stuff, it is NSA. Estimates are, they get $15 to $30 billion every year for whatever it is that they do. Right? So if they need to take care of stuff which is worry about internal attackers, it's a big problem. Right? So this is required. Monitoring is there, it's pointless, but authentication, authorization is required. But no automation, no amount of automation can solve business logic issues. So, if all your process allows for is a final security review. We are back to this slide, right? You only do the review here. You have not shifted left, right? That's when you're like, oh shit, someone said, client said security review has to be done. Let's go find a vendor. Right? If this is all that your process allows, because we are in the real world, you need to understand the fourth one cannot be automated. After you are done with everything and you're getting your validation done, this cannot be automated. You can automate for infrastructure, you can automate for very basic SQL injection, which is A1, right? If you have all the endpoints with you, you cannot automate for business logic issues. Because consider if you fine-tune your tool, which does automation, to be able to follow the business logic, you're spending as much time fine-tuning the tool as much as you did in development. Right? So then what do we do? Right? I can't really leave you hanging with like a question we can't answer. Right? So what can this non-automated approach look like? You want to take a photo? This is the slide, the coming slide. That's the takeaway. Consider this is what we do. When we say, we talk about application security testing, we do mapping, discovery, exploitation, mitigation, revalidation, right? Which is just like nice squares, circles and whatever, right? But we follow something called as a user-driven workflow. It's a very fairly standard workflow. Many people who do security assessments using certain tools like Burp Suite, that's a really nice tool that I like. I actually wrote a book on that. So we follow this user-driven workflow. And the things that you need to remember are, you test for input-based issues, go find the latest OWASP Top 10 2013 document, is absolutely free. It's under a BSD license. You can use it for whatever. You can actually change the graphics and sell it if you want to, right? So it's free to that level. In that, if you're looking for input-based bugs, you have to look at A1, A3, A4, A8, A10. If you're looking at logic and design issues, you look at 2, 5, 6, and 7. Access control is again 2, 5, 6, and 7. Anything else is A9, which is third-party components are vulnerable. And if you're doing API testing, this can span multiple. APIs don't really have a different way of testing. They will come in the top 10, right? So you should go and ask people who talk about security in your organizations. Right? Are they following any of this? This should be step one. OWASP has another really good documentation called Application Security Verification Standard, ASVS. It's just that it has 19 verification domains. It can get very, very granular. So if you've never really thought about this, top 10 is a good place to start. But obviously you should go beyond. And OWASP.org has a lot of good resources, which are available for free for everyone for use. So this is the takeaway slide. You should take your photos and maybe ask me questions about this later. That's me. I'm the Bangalore leader for OWASP. It's a global nonprofit. I also run a company called Appsecco. I'm a director there. I wrote a book on Burp Suite. Null is another security community I'm part of. Null and OWASP do regular monthly meets in Bangalore. They are completely free and open to attend. There's no registration required. You can go to the website and come and attend if you're interested in security. And I'm a trainer, so trainers are there. This is about my company. We do application security and a bunch of things around OWASP and OSCP and stuff. Questions? I finished 5 minutes early.
Yeah, so that 5 minutes is needed for two questions.
I'll be outside, don't worry, I can answer questions later as well.
Hi, so all this makes sense even when I'm deploying it at a VM level. So when I'm deploying it at a container level, the presenter just before said that since there's a shared kernel, it is more vulnerable. So what are the additional steps that I need to take care of apart from this when I'm doing it at a container level?
Okay, I'm going to assume that when you say container, you mean Docker. Because that's my experience level, I've never tried any other container runtime. Sure. Okay. Docker security page clearly states that container isolation should never be misunderstood to be for security. Okay? The cool thing is the newer kernels that Linux has something for isolating processes, networks, right? Which is called namespaces. It has a very granular way of limiting what a particular process has access to with control groups. Right? Additionally, at the level of kernel, there are some additional things you can do, which is like seccom, SE Linux, app armor. Right? Consider these are what you call them as mandatory access control architecture. One that we know of, the file and permission thing that was called discretionary access, right? That is not enough. So one of the things that is available to you is called capabilities. What do capabilities let you do? Capabilities let you define that does this process, and I'll say process because as far as a host operating system is concerned, a modern Linux operating system, container is a process. It's nothing more. Right? Inside the container, it may think of whatever, but outside, it is a process. So it can say, hey process, you are not allowed to open a raw socket. If you're not allowed to open a raw socket, you cannot do the ping command. You can try it, you can type ping, but we will not allow it, right? So by default, now in Docker, especially after 1.10, and the current one is I think 1.13, runtime version, every container that you run, by default drops all capabilities. So if you need some additional capabilities, you have to start the process asking for those capabilities. Who can start a process? Some user. So that user needs to have the privilege to allow that access. Right? But there are enough number of container breaks where people have managed to read data or memory. Data you need on the disk, memory is RAM. From the container process because of kernel level security issues. So what did they manage to do? They managed to elevate the privilege of the user running the container to someone who's root. Right? So your Docker security page even now says that do not consider isolation as a security measure. But whatever is a good hygiene for keeping a Linux virtual machine safe and secure, the same applies here. What you can't take care of, and which a virtual machine also cannot allow you to do, is like if someone figures out how to read the network stack provided by the host, which is virtualized, because the interface you get is basically written in software, right? If someone is able to read all the data coming in, going out at the host level, then no VM container isolation can save you, right? So it is just a threat model. But if consider that it makes it so easy for devs to deploy stuff, maybe they can spend more time doing security stuff. So overall, we become secure. But by default, nothing happens. And I definitely recommend if you've not look at the Docker security page. They keep updating it. At this point, that page is the most updated thing you will find on the internet for what are the modern Linux security initiatives. In fact, on 21st or 22nd of this month, we are doing a free workshop at NULL on Linux modern Linux kernel security. So you may want to check out that as well. Does that answer your question? Cool.
Hi, Akash. That was a really nice session. Thank you.
Thank you.
I really like the word that you said, monitoring is not...
You like what? Sorry?
You said that, you know, monitoring is not security.
Yep.
So, we kind of monitor, but I work for a SaaS application, which is in cloud. So, we keep getting these threats, like, you know, somebody tried to access the failed logins.
Yep.
So, they do this forge, anti-forgery tokens, and, you know, they come from different IPs.
Yeah.
We kind of monitor, but we still are not sure how to, you know, control it.
Is your token sufficiently random?
Yes.
Then you're good.
That kind of eats up our, RAM and its kind of application, because we are in a medium-sized cloud space, slows down our application.
So I can give you an answer which is great from a point of security, but your whosoever is basically your business person in your company will not really like the answer because of this testing term called false positives. Right? You can always run a web application firewall. Or very simply, when you identify your monitoring, right? So some alert is getting triggered. Alert gets triggered on some kind of pattern that you've identified, right? When you get an alert from a specific IP.
We kind of block those IPs.
Yeah.
But they keep coming back from those IPs.
But yeah, but that's like part of being on the internet.